Now, this is a true story. When I was in high school, there was a lightning storm happening outside, and after one lightning bolt, the power went out. The rest of my English class was cheering, knowing that without power, they'd all get sent home. But after a few seconds of cheering, I shouted over the ruckus, "Why are you all so happy? You know the lights are just going to come back on in 3, 2, 1. And then the lights came back on right then. Yes, that whole thing actually happened. Though by the time I got to 2 in my countdown, the lights were already flickering on, but they stayed on after 1, so it really was good timing there. In response, the entire class shouted my name angrily at having ruined their fun by thoroughly jinxing it. So, yeah, I have a history of jinxing it, and I managed to do so again with my Relic progression video. No sooner did I release my lovingly crafted progression concept that I spent weeks on and made multiple videos to explain, than Ian comes out with a video about Blizzard's actual plans going forward, and lo and behold, my Relic progression doesn't fit with those plans at all, rendering it pointless. Except that releasing it got Blizzard to do some actual communication, so maybe it was worth it after all. The Relic I made wouldn't work as stated since it was very much built for specs, but Blizzard is going to be more into class identity than spec identity, including with whatever system they'll implement in the next expansion. I'm not even sure how salvageable my Relic progression really is at this point, but I guess I should be counting my blessings about Blizzard in general. They're actually communicating with us. They're telling us their plans, and I have to say that just about everything he said was good news as far as I'm concerned. I mean, talking about having too many abilities trimmed and too many abilities at the spec level instead of class level really resonated with me. If, during Mists of Pandaria, I'd had Consecration and Inquisition, which were made Protection only and Retribution only after Cataclysm, respectively, then I'd have said that the class design was perfect. At least for someone like me who doesn't PvP. Granted, I had heard secondhand that at the time, PvP was too crowd control heavy to be fun during Mists of Pandaria. Again, as I don't PvP, I didn't experience that myself. About the only thing about Ian's communication that could have made it better as far as I'm concerned is stating that they're doing the specific things I want for my main spec, like bringing Denounce back, not removing Consecration, and all those other things from my video about bringing back Holy Power. I certainly hope Blizzard gets better about communication in the future, and they might already be getting too communicative. See, there was a very underreported leak of information on 4chan where someone claiming to be a Blizzard developer said what their plans were going forward. This leak included the following spoilers. Number 1, Tinkers are going to be the next hero class. They'll be able to be healers, tanks, or DPSers who use guns. Number 2, the next expansion will be all about the Dragonflights. Number 3, there'll be an orb item similar to the Legion artifact weapon or the Azerite armor we have in Battle for Azeroth. That's what my Relic progression concept could have been if I'd designed it to be class level instead of spec level. And number 4, there's talk about changing how the Horde Alliance faction system works. There were a few other pieces of information in that leak too, but I won't go into them here. Now, the reason I know about this leak is because Heal vs. Babyface reported it, and he really did not believe that the leaks were legitimate, and neither did I at the time I watched his video. This is probably why the leaks went mostly unreported, except for Heal vs. Babyface. But since the leaks, more and more has happened to hint that those leaks really were from an actual Blizzard employee. Az had a lot of reasons to suspect the leaks on 4chan were entirely fake. He went over those reasons in his video, but now, the Dragonflights are taking center stage with the next chapter of the Heart of Azeroth storyline, along with hints that Rathian is up to something again. Plus, there have already been hints that Tinkers will be the next hero class. Some part of me thinks that Blizzard actually asked this employee to get on 4chan and leak this stuff. I don't know if that's true, but it makes sense on the following levels. First of all, this allows Blizzard to gauge the players' reactions to their plans without officially announcing anything as a company. Let's face it, Blizzard screwed up with Battle for Azeroth, and if they'd gotten better player feedback sooner, then maybe they could have done better. Maybe. But the problem is, in order for Blizzard to actually announce plans, they have to be at a certain point in development. And probably that point is too late for them to change direction if Blizzard finds out they've made a mistake. Thus, unofficially announcing things early on 4chan and letting players react to those announcements so as to gauge their reactions has its positive aspects from a business perspective from Blizzard. Secondly, the first thought that I had about this was, if this was indeed on purpose and under Blizzard's orders, then this is only going to work once for Blizzard. The thing about 4chan is that anyone can claim to be a Blizzard employee and post a load of baloney on it. When I was first aware of this, I thought these leaks were an example of that baloney. I could have posted my relic progression concept and pretend that it's the gospel truth about Blizzard's plans if I really wanted to. I could have posted baloney if I'd felt like it. So if Blizzard decides to make a habit of posting information on 4chan, they can expect baloney posters to follow, trolling players, either by posting terrible ideas to make them freak out about the quality of the game, or else posting plausible good-looking ideas so as to get people's hopes up. Then I realized something. When these baloney posters come along, they'll just create a smokescreen that keep people guessing about what's actually going to be in the game. So the inevitable baloney posts are actually going to work in Blizzard's favor if they make this a habit, keeping spoilers down a bit. And maybe getting Blizzard ideas that are better than what they'd planned. So those are the reasons why I suspect that this is actually a calculated move on Blizzard's part and not a delinquent employee of Blizzard leaking us details that his bosses don't want us to know. That is kind of tinfoil hat-ish, and I could be completely wrong. This could be a set of educated guesses that someone who pays close attention to the game put together while pretending to be a Blizzard employee. Or it could be a Blizzard employee who really did leak the info against Blizzard's wishes. Or it could be someone acting under orders from Blizzard, or none of the above. We may never know. But I figured I should talk about this, and under the assumption that my tinfoil hat theory is right, and Blizzard really is fishing for feedback on their future plans, I'll give them my feedback based on the limited information that I gleaned from the 4chan leaks. The fact is, until we see the total kit that each spec is going to be getting, we won't know how good or how bad a given spec is. So keep that in mind. Class design was one of the big things that went wrong in Battle for Azeroth, and we won't be able to give any more feedback than what we've already given on class design until after we've seen an iteration of our specs or classes design that's different from Battle for Azeroth. I can tell you that I'd like to see Light of the Martyr replaced with a Word of Glory-like ability that feels different from our other heals, and that I think Holy Power deserves a comeback with features that manage to avoid Warlords of Draenor's design problems. I'd like Consecration to stay, Holy Radiance to come back, Rebuke would be a really nice to have for Holy Spect Paladins like me, and that I really, really want Denounce back, but that's about it. And I could have, and indeed did, tell you that before the leaks, but on to the leaks themselves. It seems like Blizzard is taking a lot of our ideas, which is good. I mean, we've been playing the game, we know what we like, so taking suggestions is a great thing that'll be good for the game. One thing that I forgot to mention from the leaks is that the class skins concept Taliesin has a video about, that's going to be coming into the game, but they'll call it prestige classes. The example that they have is a dragon sworn as a skin for druids, but I don't know what all else there be besides the dragon sworn. I'm hoping for Taliesin's Vindicator class, but with Radiant School replacing the Shadow School and Divine School replacing Holy School, so as to keep interrupts functioning the way they do now. Now, let's talk about the orb. Or should I? I mean, I've more or less given feedback on the general kind of thing I'd like to see and given some concrete examples of it with my defunct relic progression concept. But I'll say it here again anyway in the hopes that it separates the general from the specific. I'd like to see something that provides a progression that follows both your experience levels as you level up and that continues to provide rewards once you reach max level. If they structured the rewards in a way like what I showed for the relic, with different kinds of rewards in different tiers as you level up, that would work perfectly. Especially if some of the limitations on how you can progress disappear when you reach max level. One thing I think was promising about my relic progression was that it gave the player a taste of possible rewards during the 120 to 130, or should I say 60 to 70, leveling process. And then it opened things up massively once you hit max level. The player's appetite was whetted and to a lesser degree sated during the leveling process, and that sharpened appetite has more chances to be filled at max level as a reward for reaching max level. Also, it would be a good idea if there were a variety of types of rewards. I think the variety of types that I had in my video was perfect, with passives with different magnitudes at different tiers and with different types of changes that those passives made to your gameplay, upgrades to your existing abilities that change their flavor, and brand new active abilities at the end of the progression as rewards for completing the progression. Now, a great deal of the relic progression I'd put together was meant to give Blizzard developers the ability to add spells while avoiding things that they had been afraid of in the past, like spell bar bloat and too many abilities in general. I'm glad that they came out and said they're no longer afraid of that, at least not enough to keep them from re-adding abilities and making them class level instead of spec level, but it does make half the purpose of my relic progression moot. So, variety of rewards, added class flavor, added fun, those are the things I'd be looking for in the orb that's coming in the next expansion. Next, let's talk about tinkers. For the longest time, I had thought that sea witches would be a great addition to the roster of WoW classes for the following reasons. They can DPS with ranged weapons, which is something that only one class can do at the moment. This creates an open space which sea witches can fill. Only two classes wear mail, and since sea witches are more or less a cross between shaman and hunters, they would wear mail, and no new class has worn mail since 2004. They can be a DPS caster spec, and we haven't had a new one of those since 2004. Also, they can be a healer, and it's time for another healing spec. Tinkers fulfill 3 out of 4 of those categories. Technically, they could be a caster DPS spec if Blizzard wanted to go in that direction with them and took out the tanking spec, or if they added a fourth spec, for that matter. Also, Tinkers have been hyped by the community way more than Sea Witches have been. And given that Azshara has been the main antagonist of patch 8.2, it's hard to imagine Naga coming to the Horde and the Alliance and teaching them how to wield sea magic. At least, not anytime soon. Azshara has been portrayed by N'Zoth, so she or her followers might someday try to get on the good side of the Alliance and Horde. Maybe, but not right away. As such, tinkers are probably better at this point. They'd have a very different flavor from the existing classes. They could be very fun indeed, and they could bring more variety to the engineering profession, of which I am a proud member and have been since 2005. Now to brain dump some ideas I have for tinkers that I think Blizzard should consider. First of all, tractor beam as their distance closer. There have been a lot of wind mechanics that raid bosses and world rares have used to make things interesting, pushing players without being a knockback per se. No player character has had access to these wind mechanic abilities, so adding one that functions as a distance closer would make tinkers feel very different. I'd recommend a tractor beam that sends out a cone of suction so that it could draw in multiple different caster enemies to the tank. A second thing I'd like to suggest for tinkers is actually ray guns. And that's because one of the few graphics that isn't common in the game is a straight line beam. Just about every channeled graphic zigs or zags or spirals, but straight line beams are rare. Holy Prism is about the only one in existence. Blizzard can add straight line beam graphics to tinkers to make them look different. I'd recommend that at least one straight line beam ability should deal arcane damage, because at the moment only two classes can do arcane damage. It's an underutilized damage type, as is Frost now that I think about it. Maybe prestige classes were an attempt to add more damage types to the game? I don't know. Another type of ray gun that I'd like to suggest is a repulsor ray gun. That is, an ability that's a pushback like the opposite of the tractor beam. We've got plenty of snares and roots in the game, and some knockback effects here and there, but we've never tried a pushback as a substitute for a slower and immobilize effect. At least not for players. It could be pretty sweet, and it might be something that Blizzard would want to experiment with. My third suggestion is probably going to be my most controversial one, that the Tinker's healing spec should be called their Holy spec. Hear me out on this. Back during Cataclysm, there were blue posts responding to questions about why gnomes could suddenly be priests that assured us that gnomes had long been interested in the Holy Light, and only just after the fall of the Lich King did they get a chance to start looking into it. And in this blue post were teases that we'd see some light-based gnomish technology coming to us. I had hoped, oh so much, that this would mean a resurgence of gnomish engineering versus goblin engineering, a dichotomy of engineering specializations that was huge, both good and huge, in vanilla. That dichotomy tapered off in the Burning Crusade and hasn't really been seen since Mists of Pandaria, but as Illyria and Terralian's reappearance in Legion can testify, Blizzard can take older concepts that they had put down years ago, pick them up again, and come up with something good. I'm hoping that they do that with this whole light-based technology concept, ideally by mixing it into gnomish engineering, but it would also fit perfectly by adding to the way Tinker's Heel, to apply some light-based technology to make that happen. Plus, Holy is an underutilized element as well, and it could tie into the way that light and death are supposed to be aligned with each other these days. And when you think about it, what is the single most advanced piece of technology that the Horde or Alliance has ever had at their disposal? The Vendikar, which leaves me wondering why it hasn't been used in Battle for Azeroth against the Horde, but that's a whole nother video. The point is, the Vendikar is light-based technology, and incorporating that advanced tech into their kits is just the kind of thing that a tinker would want to do. Moving right along, let's talk about the focus on the Dragonflights. I personally think this is a promising next step, and as a guy who's played since vanilla, I can tell you the Dragonflights weren't always as chummy with mortals as they are today. In the Burning Crusade, the Bronze Dragonflight started asking players for help in the Caverns of Time, and about all the Dragonflights except the blue one were asking for players' help in Northrend, but in vanilla, that was all another story. Nearly every dragon that you got near would attack you on sight. Red Dragonkin in the Wetlands? Those were high-level elites that you could farm as an epicked-out level 60 player. And they wanted you dead. Anachronos in Tanaris? A world boss that patrolled around that, again, raids of players could kill back in vanilla. Green Dragons in the Swamp of Sorrows? Again, they would kill you on sight. Once in a while, there'd be a dragon NPC who would be willing to talk to you and give you a quest, but those were few and far between. For the most part, the Dragonflights were enemies of the Alliance and the Horde back in vanilla. We might end up going back to that scenario. It wouldn't be the first time a faction had been friendly for us and then became enemies. Alliances in World of Warcraft shift just like alliances in real life do. Also, as I thought about this, I thought, you know, Alexstrasza could be the final boss of the next expansion. It's a bit more plausible than you'd think. Every one of the original five dragon aspects, except for Alexstrasza, has had some kind of corruption happen to them. Neltharion went mad and became Deathwing because of Old God Whispers, Ysera ended up corrupted by the Tears of Ilun, Nazdormo will become Murozond at some point, and he's also Void-influenced, and while it's not clear whether the Void had anything to do with Malagos's corruption, Malagos still went bad. Alexstrasza is the only one left, and if I were her, I'd be expecting the Void to come after me at any time, and I'd be looking to find a way to stave off the Void's corruption however I could. And guess who's immune to the Void? That's right, the undead. As the light is getting chummy with death, so too might life. Or at least, Alexstrasza might. Keep in mind, Buonsamdi's boss is female. Could his boss be Alexstrasza? To make that make sense, Blizzard would need to lay down a lot more story about what Alexstrasza's been up to. I wouldn't think it would be in her character to get into undeath, but you have to admit, she'd make a badass final boss for an expansion, and Blizzard is running out of characters to use. Plus, if her red dragonkin can be our enemies near Grim Batol, well, so could Alexstrasza herself. The lore that I have speculated on so far would have potential to tie into the lore that we've gotten about death as a fundamental force in the Azeroth universe, and this could be the death expansion that big names in WoW have speculated on, like Taliesin and Balior Gaming. Wouldn't have to be, of course, but it could be. Now for the final and probably most controversial part, the changes to the faction system. I am choosing my wording very carefully because it's not at all clear just what will happen with the Horde and the Alliance. Blizzard has said, in the past, It's not World of Peacecraft, and the Alliance and Horde have different goals and different challenges, so peace between them is unlikely. But we have Jaina and Thrall as friends, and we have Anduin and the probable next leader of the Horde, Bane, as personal friends as well. It's hard to picture the Horde and Alliance still being at war with those two running the show, but if they were to be at peace, it would completely change the world of Azeroth and the fundamental aspects of the game. Change, even fundamental change, isn't necessarily bad or good, and as I repeatedly state, I don't PvP, so about the only thing I can provide about faction changes is an outsider opinion. But I will give that opinion now. First and foremost, PvP and conflict are still very, very possible in a world where the Horde and Alliance are at peace. But the source of the conflict would need to change. Here's what I'm thinking. There could still be factions within the Alliance and factions within the Horde that are at odds with each other, sometimes to the point of coming to blows over their differences. For example, imagine if Gallywix had acquired the Venture Company and wanted to mine a particular area, and imagine if there was a Dwarven mining company that also wanted to mine that same area. If the ore was valuable enough, they might actually fight over who gets to mine it. While the official armies of the Alliance and Horde wouldn't get involved in that, the two corporations might hire mercenaries and adventurers, i.e. players, to do the fighting for them. That kind of conflict has a much more localized and zone-specific flavor to it, but it still feels like a Horde-Alliance conflict, and it could still perfectly lead to PvP in Battlegrounds just the same way as the Alliance-Horde conflict did in Battle for Azeroth and before. Also, rereading the paragraph that I wrote about factions within the Alliance and Horde being at odds, I realized this wouldn't just mean from Alliance factions being at odds with from Horde factions. It could also mean from Alliance factions being at odds with other from Alliance factions, and from Horde factions being at odds with other from Horde factions. Heck, factions that aren't from either the Horde or the Alliance could be at odds with each other, and players could be allowed to choose which ones to support and which ones to fight against. Just about any conflict is possible, and with there being hints about fractures within the Alliance coming up, we might just see that as a potential driver for PvP. It's not clear exactly what the new faction system is going to be like, though. Still, I'm not super worried about the possibilities of an end to the Horde Alliance split. It might actually open the way for new and deeper stories. Some stories with more limited scope, some maybe with greater scope. Heck, stories that start small could end up big as things escalate, or new technologies, magic, or materials are discovered, or as coalitions between factions begin to form. For that matter, conflicts with big scopes could end up small as coalitions break up or as materials get depleted. And even that shrinkage of scope has the possibility of adding something to the drama of the story. We'll have to see what Blizzard actually does with the faction system. It's not clear what it will be, how it will play out, or if Blizzard will even attempt to revamp the faction system at all. If they do revamp it, then there could be new progressions of reputation that would allow Alliance players to enter Orgrimmar or Thunderbluff, or that would allow Horde players to enter Ironforge or the Exodar. That could be an interesting progression, especially if there are rewards in those cities that you can't get anywhere else. Not sure how that would work, but there's potential. Finally, I'd like to say that in an expansion where the Horde-Alliance conflict ends, the most lore logical way to make sure that long war stays over and done, and to make it look like the leaders are trying to make a real attempt at making that peace stick, is to have a lot of trade agreements between the Horde and the Alliance. That was where Thrall and Varian started in one of the comics taking place around Wrath of the Lich King or so. And there's good reason for this. As a general rule, places where goods cross borders often are places where soldiers cross borders infrequently. And if we're going to have the story focus on trade, there could be a focus in the gameplay on professions. Now, I'm definitely a professions junkie, so I'll admit I'm biased about what the expansion should focus on. But there's a lot of untapped potential in professions. For instance, we could have our champions, not from our garrison, not from our class order hall, or even from our faction, but from our profession. It's about the only thing that they haven't done when it comes to champions who we can send out on missions at this point. Also, there could be a lot of different rewards that they give us for completing our professions, including rewards that count as recipes from previous expansions now that Blizzard has shifted the skill point system for professions. They could go all out adding cosmetic rewards that allow us to craft weapons and armor from previous expansions that are no longer available in-game. Hopefully, they continue with the trend of permitting weapons crafting on professions other than just blacksmithing. I was pretty thrilled when engineers could craft one-handed maces, as I play a holy paladin and am also an engineer. I've been both since the summer of 2005. But then, well, the fact is, there were very few recipes that actually let me make a healing mace that I could actually use, and those were quickly outclassed by weapons that I could get from dungeons or even from plain old quests. So, as awesome as crafting more weapons looked on paper, in the end, it wasn't all that useful, though it could have been a terrific reward if Blizzard had decided to keep the items that professions could craft interesting and made them scale up properly. Actually, that's been one of Blizzard's weaknesses in general, figuring out how to get players good gear. In the earlier expansions like Wrath of the Lich King and Cataclysm, crafted gear could be as good as or almost as good as raid level, provided, of course, that the player was able to get the high-end materials, and I hope that Blizzard will consider making craftable gear and weapons on par with raid level stuff again, including making weapons so that they're craftable or upgradable until they're at or very near raid level. If they don't, well, professions aren't really going to be that rewarding. In the past, I've talked about how I'd like elemental reagents to come back. I've tried nearly everything to convince the developers to bring elemental reagents back. I've tried offering some free programming help to them. I've tried expounding Greek philosophy. I've even tried a trick involving a dinner plate, 10 white chocolates, geometry, and 3 giant kitchen knives, which sounds really funny and weird when you take it out of context. But if they finally make an expansion that gives profession center stage, it might finally happen. They might finally bring elemental reagents back into the game. And boy, do I hope that they implement elemental reagents correctly, like they did in the first three expansions, not badly, like they did in Warlords of Draenor. To recap, 1, don't attach the generation of elemental reagents to clunky, unfun systems like the daily cooldown items. 2, don't set up a system where the motes that could make elemental reagents need to be saved for other, higher priority materials that are hard to get in other ways. And 3, don't neglect to have the items that you craft with those elemental reagents carry forward some of the elemental reagents' flavor. For example, don't have sorcerous air be necessary to craft an item called Blackrock Rifling. Instead of just calling it Blackrock Rifling, call it electroplated Blackrock Rifling. And don't require sorcerous water to be used to create Hexweave Essence. Have sorcerous water be required to make an item called Well-Washed Hexweave Essence. Stuff like that, even if it's just a slight tweak to the naming, goes a long way to improving the flavor of the items and the profession. Anyhow, that's about it for my reaction to the news that Blizzard has come out with. I probably should have made this video sooner, but now that I have published this video, I'll have jinxed it. And probably within hours of its release, Blizzard will info dump more details about their plans going forward that'll render my video mostly moot. At least, I can hope that'll happen.